morning, everyone. My name is Tathagat. I'm happy to be here. And, well, honestly, Tathagat, I don't know what to say in a welcome note. So I didn't prepare anything, so there are no slides here. I do want to send a message to all of you that we don't need slides for being agile. Right? So I just want to keep it a little lightweight here. But I'm thankful to Saket for giving this opportunity. When he reached out to me, I think it was about 4 months back, he said, hey, we are planning to do something here in Delhi. I want your help. I said, I'm more than happy. Whatever I can help you, I'll be happy to do that. I live in Bangalore, so I'm not from Delhi. And nice to be here. I know the same place. Sarab was here last year. Many of us met here. There's kind of a deja vu for many of us here. But I think this is a different day, it's a different conference, it's a different event. A lot of you are new here, so let me just share with a few things here. First of all, I always make it a point to kind of learn to know how many of you here. I know Saket made you raise your hands a couple of times. I'll just do once more. How many of you paid for your own conference? Well, can we give a big round of applause to all these people? I think it's a big thing. I know we expect a lot from our organizations, but then the fact that roughly about 80-85% of you raised your hands and you paid for this, that demonstrates the kind of commitment you have for your own self-improvement. I think but the very fact of you signing up, going to the website, swiping your card itself shows that you are agile in your thinking. So good job to all of you. You're going to spend next 2 days you're going to be away from your family for next 2 days, spending time in this room. I think it's upon all of us to make sure that your experiences are good. So, but thanks for that support to the community, because without which we would not be able to do events like this. So about the event, and I was going through the speakers and the topics. I think you're going to have 2 good days of interactions. Use the time as much as you can. I just want to call out a few things. I've been a software practitioner for more than about 2 dozen years now. I do now independent consulting. I go and talk to a lot of companies and execs. I'm just trying to call out some of the things that I'm seeing there from my pair of eyes as what are some of the big challenges I'm seeing there. And I hope they might be valuable to you, so that when you leave this room at the end of 2 days, at least from my point of view, I don't think it's important for you to get the right answers. Trust me, there are no right answers. You have to make them right. That's what I believe in. What is to me more important and more valuable is, do you have the right questions? Are you able to go back and have a conversation with people with the right set of questions? So I hope for your own sake, your ROI is not going to be getting some ready-made cookie cutter solutions and answers that say, hey, just go and checklist this and then you are done. I don't think there's anything agile about it. If at all there is anything agile about it, it's being able to ask those meaningful questions, it's being able to initiate those conversations, it's being able to call out some insights and lead people towards those collaboration. I think that's what is agility all about. So from my point of view, I want to share with you 2 perspectives here, which I am seeing a lot of trend. One is on the end, what are the anchors of agility? And the second is the drivers of agility. So I just want to talk about these two in the next 15 minutes. In my view, the anchors of agility are really only 2. You will see a lot of mechanics and nuts and bolts of that. It is important, don't get me wrong. It's important to be able to do a stand-up meeting properly. It's important to be able to do the planning focus session properly. But don't get caught up in that. I listen to about 30-odd user groups globally all over the world, and I'm still amazed to see a lot of questions are all around the mechanics of that. I think people have missed the whole notion of agility by miles, actually. So I just want to talk about that and set the context. To me, the first and most important thing is all about having the right agile mindset. Agility as a process is, I think, it's a non-starter in my view. But agility is a mindset, has a promise. Some of you who were there last year when we had Dave Thomas come down to Bangalore and deliver the keynote where he talked about the whole notion that agile is dead, and that video is there on the YouTube as well. Go and watch that video. I think he made a very compelling point about it. We have been caught up in this trap of, hey, this is this one agile process. You follow this blindly, and you're all set. I think it cannot be any further from truth. What is more important is the whole conversation about agile thinking and agile mindset. So some of the, to me, some of the conversations from people like Linda Rising about agile mindset, and some of you I'm sure have had the chance to listen to her in person. She has been to India a couple of times here. I think those are valuable. What is not important is to really go with 5 pages of documentation that says that this is the agile process, just go and run with that. What is more important is your learning DNA that allows you to have a curious mindset, a beginner's mindset. Ask the questions. Question everything there before you are really satisfied. It doesn't mean that we are going to be an expert cynic in everything. It's good to be a cynic. It's not probably good to be a chronic cynic probably. But it's good to have a beginner's mindset and keep asking questions, evaluate things. Is this the right thing that we are doing here? Could there be a better way of doing it? Agile mindset to me is also all about not stealing away the best practices. I this is my pet peeve. Best practices have been oversold by the management consultants like me. Don't trust them. Best practices, in my view, is not best practices are created by well-meaning professionals who undertake a journey, and it is the end result of their endeavors. Best practices are not something that you can lift and shift and straight away go and apply them and hope to get the same kind of results. Best practices, in my view, is a culmination of all the hard work, blood, sweat, tears that they have actually put in to come to a point where they say, hey, we know how it works now. And that, the sum total of that is what we call as the best practices. I can write an article on that and I can say, this is the best practice, but it may not even work for you. Because you have a totally different context. Your people are different, your business is different, the customers are different, everything is different about it. You will have to create your own best practices. So think about it, an agile mindset is not something that actually is all about just picking something from the air and saying, hey, oh, that great company was successful because of that, let me also go and do that thing. You will have to grow your own food. You will have to hunt your own food and you will have to make your own dinner. That is, to me, the agile mindset. The second thing that I am consistently seeing is, and that again, is really a call of leadership. And by leadership, I don't think it's a call of the designated leadership. Because in an agile context, we are all leaders. The most important thing I think agile has kind of brought in is this big shift from leadership by title or leadership by hierarchy or leadership by authority to leadership by influence. Right? And that's the reason why I say everybody is a leader here. You don't need to have a title or rank on your shoulder to say that I can make something different or I can change something. If you have the ability to influence people, you are a leader. And conversely, if you cannot influence anybody, you cease to be a leader anymore. So, and that's the reason why it's important, because the second important anchor in my view of agility is the culture piece. You can have fancy plans, you can have great strategy, you can have all the nice posters on the wall. But guess what? Everything about culture is all about, to me, how people behave in the absence of any written guidance. It's all about how people, in fact, nowadays when I step into organizations, the science of agility, if I want to look at it, I start looking at if there is a room full of people and they leave the meeting, what is the state of that meeting room when they have left the meeting room? Does it look like there has been just a big battle there that has gone on? We have like, you have 43 coffee cups lying all over the place. Do you see lights switched off? Do you see the chairs are just left random? If you cannot do that, you probably are not going to do refactoring very well in my view. Because remember the Boy Scout rule: leave the place better than what you found it in. Right? If we are not going to take care of the common property and the common assets of an organization, I don't think we can have a different set of mindset which is going to be switched on automatically the moment we reach our desktops. This has to be a single mindset which has to be seamless across whether you are sitting on your code or whether you're sitting away from your code with the people. So I try to look for those symptoms of how people interact with each other, how people behave with each other, how people respect each other in the corridors. If you cannot have the same level of respect for people in the hallways and the elevators, you probably are not going to have a synthetic behavior when Agile talks about respect and transparency and teamwork and collaboration. So I try to look for some of these factors when I talk to people. Now, generally in a large organization, it's the leadership's call to really have to do the context setting and goal setting and really say what is the right culture we want to create here. I'm reading this fabulous book. Has anyone heard of this book, Work Rules? It's written by the head of HR at Google. I don't remember his first name. His last name is Laszlo, L-A-S-Z-O. I've read only 3 chapters by now. Amazing, amazing book. Do yourself a favor. You've already paid money for this conference. Pay another $15. Buy an e-book of that book, and you will be blown away by what you read about that. So read about how, and it's not, I'm not, Google didn't pay me money for endorsing this book. But read that book, and I think there are some great insights about what a knowledge organization should be all about. How are we going to build a knowledge organization? What are the cultural nuances of a knowledge-based organization that we should all be looking forward to? Don't worry about the mechanics of that. Don't worry about whether it can be done in Jira or Atlassian or Rally or what have you. First, focus on the first principles, how human beings can best be motivated and can be most effective when they collaborate, when you throw them together in a room. I think that's, for me, the second part of it. So these were the two anchors, mindset and culture. Mindset is at an individual level, culture is at a collective level, and that's why sometimes it's a higher order calling. It's important to have the right culture, but I don't believe the right culture can be created without having the right mindset in place. So there you have these two. The second point I want to talk about are the three drivers. Now, the three drivers from my point of view, what I'm seeing today, and I think this to me is more contextual in India as well, and I don't think there's any difference from the rest of the world. Of course, we have to have the agility in execution. That's the first point there in drivers. Random conversations. People who were doing things in 12 months now have to do 4 times in 12 months period. Whether it comes to release, whether it comes to customer feedback, whether it comes to new product launch, whether it comes to update. I think the pace at which we are expected to do is extremely high. So there is no doubts about that. The second thing is all about quality in workmanship. Unfortunately, what I've seen is, and I just want to request you to raise your hand once again. How many people here who are following Agile are doing practices like test-driven development, refactoring? Can they raise their hands, please? So if you can keep your hands raised, I don't wish to put anyone in spot, but I would request all of you to just look around this room. I think this number is less than 5%. I think it's a big concern. As an Agile practitioner, I think it's a big concern. And the big concern is because we have been sold the diet of management frameworks for a far too long time, that we have stopped worrying about the craftsmanship. We have stopped worrying about the workmanship of our products there. I don't think, when you read those fancy articles that say Amazon does push to production every 11.3 seconds, we are overawed by those ideas, but we don't realize that it requires a lot of engineering rigor to be able to deliver and sustain that level of quality that if you are Amazon.com, you will be able to deliver at that pace. When we read about continuous delivery, and when we read about things like WordPress, Automatic has been releasing WordPress, they have done 19,000 releases in a period of 5 years. That number is more than that, which essentially translates to about 17 or 19 push to production every single day, sustained over 5 year period. I don't think you can do that pace of changes if you do not have a sound engineering practice and an infrastructure in place. So I think the time has come for us to go back and reevaluate that it's not just about having a bunch of people and doing cute little stand-ups and post-its and what have you. It's about also making sure that we are going back and grinding the axe and making sure that the code that we are writing, the document that we are writing, the product that we are shipping out are of highest quality that we would like to ship. I think that's an important part to me. And the third and most important part to me is 360 degrees of innovation. I call it 360 degrees of innovation because I don't think that we sometimes tend to overrate the innovation in only one area and we tend to underrate the innovation in other areas. For example, if you ask randomly people, I'm sure 3/4 of the people will say Apple is a great innovation company, right? I mean, in terms of the products and the ideas, they do that. Yesterday I was watching a video of how they designed their retail stores, and Apple has actually created that into a science, where they have a red zone, they have a green zone, and they have an orange zone, where every Apple store, the 473 Apple stores all over the world, they have exactly the same way of doing it. So their workmanship, their innovation, their ability to think about what makes people happy about the products and services, is not just limited to the way the products are built. It is all about the experience. The moment you step into an Apple store, the moment you see these zones, they are created for a right purpose. They are created there for an experience. And that's the reason why I say innovation is a 360-degree process. It is not something that can be limited and say, oh, by the way, we are doing product development, we can be innovative. Now that we are beginning to sell it, why do we need to have innovation there? I think innovation is all about the entire buying cycle, entire value creation process that has to be there. Because obviously, you know, innovation is important. You cannot create a light bulb by continuously improving the candle, as the old saying goes. You can only make a better candle, but if you want to make an electric bulb, you will have to innovate and you will have to step out of your comfort zone and stop making candles so that you can start making the electric bulb. I think that's a given. Innovation is, specifically, let me talk about India, Indian context here. We have a great software industry. We ship out $77 to $80 billion of software every year. Unfortunately, I still believe that the innovation quotient of our country is very close to zero. I would still like to believe that $77 billion there's a disproportionately smaller amount of money that is actually going into real new to the world, as I like to call it. The new to the world ideas are extremely low. We need the level of rigor, for example, which a person of name James Dyson. Has anyone heard of James Dyson? So James Dyson was a salesman of vacuum cleaner back in late 70s. He's Sir James Dyson, by the way. And he felt that there has to be a better way of building vacuum cleaners. And he went out and experimented for 5 years, and he failed for 5,127 times before he built world's best vacuum cleaner that does not require bags. How many of our companies in this room or outside this room are willing to continuously fail 5,127 times so that they can build a vacuum cleaner that can sell at 1,200 pounds, which is the world's best vacuum cleaner, as he likes to call it? That to me is the spirit of innovation. The spirit of innovation is not about hitting a velocity number and saying, oh, we are continuously hitting our velocity. Please remember that. That is important, no doubt about it. But end of the day, I think we need to understand that the non-linearity that our industry talks about, if we have to get into the big league, there cannot be any other way but to screw up. If we are not willing to screw up, if we are not willing to make mistakes, if we are not willing to fall down and stumble, if we are not willing to challenge ourselves in that process, if we are not willing to step out of the comfort zone, if we are not willing to put in 40 hours a day of effort of challenging ourselves, I don't believe we will be anywhere. 5 years down the line, we will still be talking about nuts and bolts of Agile. To me, Agile is not the end. Agile is only one of the ingredients. You don't get scotch by having all the right ingredients. You have to put the ingredients and then you have to take it through the process and then you get the scotch. This is one of the other ingredients that has to go into that. Your end is not to be Agile, believe me. Your end is to use agility. If the agility is not giving you any business results, kill your Agile program. Fire your Agile coaches. I was reading the other day the article by Jeff Sutherland. I think he wrote that article last year. He said in the Bay Area, 80%, he asked a room full of execs from the Bay Area tech companies. 80% of those people are not shipping working software at the end of sprints. And those companies are beginning to fire Agile coaches. Please fire your Agile coaches if they cannot help you deliver a working software. That's an important part of it. The other day I was reading this article by the outgoing CEO of Cisco, John Chambers. And he was again in a room full of, where he said, 40% of you, I have a bad news for you, 40% of you will not exist in the same shape or form in 10 years from now. That is the pace at which things are happening there. If you continue to keep improving and only keep looking at the status quo, I don't believe that 10 years from now, most of these names will exist there. In fact, Standard & Poor's S&P 500 index, the biggest 500 companies by market cap on New York Stock Exchange and NASDAQ are in the S&P 500 index. So these are the 500 biggest companies on earth that we know today. Guess what? Every 2 weeks, one company out of that 500 gets replaced and some new player comes and joins it. When the biggest of the 500 companies are not immune from death and obsolescence, you and I are much smaller flies here, believe me. I think we need to understand that we have to really take that in our hands. Take that, break the rules, Have you done anything that makes you go in front of your manager and say, hey, sorry, I didn't mean to break the rules, but I have to do that? When was the last time you broke the rules of bureaucracy and red tape in order to get something done in your organization? That is agility. Agility is not about blind compliance to a written down process, a laminated process that says, do it this way, do it this way, do it that way. So I just want to close it down with my rant here. I'm done with the rant. Please examine what we are doing, why are we doing. To me, why is an extremely important component of being agile. If you are not asking why, you are not being agile, you are just doing agile. So go back and then ask and re-examine the fundamentals of why are we doing in the first place. Maybe there is a better way of doing it. Maybe there is no need to do that, right? Like in the Lean Startup, I do a lot of work in Lean Startup, design thinking and other forums. One of the biggest things that we ask in Lean Startup is, why do we even need to write code? If all you need to do is get customer feedback, can you do it without writing the code? So one of the pet process that I follow is the Google Ventures process. We go to gb.com/design, you can learn about the design sprint. Where what we tell is, if you want to show a prototype to somebody, you start making the prototype in PowerPoint. And then you use tools like Kinotopia, and you create a working prototype in half an hour flat without writing a single line of code. Question yourself, if the only reason you are writing code is to do prototype, stop it. Find better ways of getting the feedback. So I think agile mindset is not about really questioning why are we doing something, how can we do it better. In the next 2 days, we will have a lot of conversations. I'm sure the team has done a great job in curating the speakers and the papers there. Please always look at, these are some of the great experiences that people are coming up with. I'm sure there's a lot of learning in that. Go back to those and also examine back and say, why are you doing something? Don't just look at applying some of these best practices and say, hey, Monday morning, I'm going to go back to my boss and apply on some of these things. Translate, adapt these things so that you can find out what is best for your business there. So I look forward to also interacting with all of you during the breakout sessions and so on. I look forward to having a great conference there. All the best to the conference side. Thank you.
Thank you. So it's a token of appreciation from our side to the target. Please have a photograph, just wait for a minute. Thank you.